Imagine you are a patient. You're in your patient gown, and you are sitting waiting for your doctor to come into the room for your annual exam. The doctor walks in and asks, "Do you mind if I record our visit today on my cell phone? We are piloting a new medical scribe powered by artificial intelligence, which will take our recording, it will transcribe it into a note, and put it into my electronic medical record." I am really excited about this because that means that I get to spend more time with patients, spend less time at the end of the day writing notes, and I get to go home and have dinner with my family. 1,000 questions starts running through your head. What is this AI-powered medical scribe your trusted doctor is using? Where is it stored? Who controls and monitors it? And what about your privacy? And is it fair that you have to make a snap decision because you're sitting here in your gown and you just got this information? As an internist with an MBA, I have always had one foot in the clinical world and one foot in the business world. Spending years as the chief medical officer for a Fortune 100 company, I had a front row seat to numerous IT implementations that were meant to solve clinical problems and make the interaction between doctors and patients a better one. But I will tell you, the impact of business decisions often are not what we intend or expect, especially when it comes to the practice of medicine and the art of taking care of patients. The sense of place in healthcare, it is that emotional connection and that comfort that patients feel when they're sitting face to face with their established physicians. It is a place where trust, empathy, and that sense of good being exist and great communication. And it is that strong bond with patients and doctors that goes to patient satisfaction, adherence to treatment, and overall health outcomes. Artificial intelligence is transforming healthcare with its diagnostic power and its administrative efficiency. And it is reshaping the traditional healthcare landscape in ways that my colleagues and I never imagined when we graduated from medical school over 30 years ago. In the old days, when I was a medicine resident back in the 1990s, for an office visit, we would sit face-to-face with our patients with pencil and paper in hand. I would try to minimize the number of notes that I wrote. I would make eye contact, maintain it, because I wanted the patient to know, I'm listening, I care. Then, at the end of that visit, I would go out into the hallway. I would go into my white coat pocket and grab my trusty tape recorder. I would dictate my note, give the tape to the transcriptionist, who would then write the note for me, type it out, and it would be on my desk the next day for my review and signature. Now enter electronic medical records. Now, instead of a piece of paper and pencil between the doctor and patient, there's a computer. And instead of the doctor making eye contact with the patient, they are focused on the typed word on the screen. Electronic medical records were it was supposed to streamline all those administrative processes and actually result in less work. But that's not what happened. So many physicians had to hire an in-person medical scribe to help them with all this new burden of documentation. Now enter artificial intelligence. So here now we have a technology that can take a conversation, can transcribe it into a note and put it into the electronic medical record. So that means that in-person medical scribe, we don't need them anymore. But that is only half the story. A recent study by the Physician Advocacy Institute found that 3 out of 4 physicians are employed by either hospitals, healthcare organizations, or corporate entities. That means that decisions such as should we use an AI technology is no longer in the hands of the physicians, but instead of the business executives of the entity that owns them. As a physician executive, I will tell you that vetting clinical technology products, it is a complex and it's a difficult process. Often business executives, they do not have a clear understanding of how technology impacts the front lines where doctors are seeing patients. And those frontline physicians who know best what the impact is, they're not being included in the vetting process. So let's go back to our original scenario. Here we have the doctor coming in saying to the patient, "Do you mind if I use my medical scribe powered by AI that the entity that owns my practice told me I have to use?" How did we get here? So the doctor got a memo saying you must use this new technology. The office manager comes in and tells the doctor, "We have to fire Susie, our in-person medical scribe." The business executives comes in saying, "This is going to be great. We are going to save you so much time. You are going to have work-life balance." And then you have the IT people come in. They download it onto the doctor's phone and to the computer and shows them how to use it. But chances are the doctor, besides knowing the name of the medical application and knowing how to use it, has no idea where it's being stored, who is monitoring and controlling it, and what about the patient's privacy. Now, I will say it does feel like often when you go to a doctor's office or to the hospital, HIPAA, patient privacy, patient rights, sometimes it seems like an afterthought. I recently was at an outpatient clinic. I was getting a test, and the registration agent said to me, "Please look at the screen. Can you scroll down 15 pages? This is all about your patient rights and privacy. Oh, can you sign on the bottom line? And can you please hurry? There's 3 people behind you." Well, I gotta say, we have to challenge this paradigm, especially when it comes now to AI technologies. Because whatever you put in to that engine for AI, even if it's depersonalized, you know what? It's a risk. So to this point, we've really only been talking about AI medical scribes that take notes and put them into the electronic medical record. What about those AI technologies that now start to help with clinical decision making and making treatment recommendations? Patients trust doctors because they're highly educated and they're going to do the right thing in the best interest of the patient. But they also know what is behind the curtain when it comes to clinical algorithms. They know the patient data being inputted and they know the output of the treatment recommendation. But with artificial intelligence, there's a black box. And so often, the doctor is not privy to the clinical decision tree that's in that black box. Now you ask, how can that be? Well, many AI technologies, they are owned by tech companies who have heavy investments from venture capitalists, from hedge funds. So that's very valuable, what's in that black box. So it's labeled proprietary, and the doctor doesn't get to peek inside. So new technologies, they always bring great excitement. And often the momentum of the implementation and the adoption, it gets ahead of the regulation and the oversight. A recent study from the American Medical Association on augmented intelligence focused on patient privacy, patient protections for those who are putting their data into AI engines. Recommendations that, one, patients should always be able to opt out, and at no point in the process should there be any repersonalization of the data. And third-party data holders, they need to be held responsible and take some accountability. But most importantly, the oversight in this exploding industry must be addressed immediately from a political, from a legislative, and legal, and ethical standpoint. Our original scenario really shows a breakdown of the system. The business executive, the one who bought the program and implemented it, they just did not understand the impact before they flipped the switch. The doctor was not educated in the ramifications of using this technology. And the patient, they felt pressured. And they felt they had to make a decision without knowing where their data was going and how it was being protected. The solution is the engagement of all stakeholders and also good communication. So the business executive, anytime they're considering any type of AI technology, the doctor needs to be there to answer the who, what, where, why, and how. You need that clinical input. Now the doctor, that doctor needs to raise their voice, and they need to ask questions, and they need to say no. I need to know more information about this technology instead of just being told to use it. And the patient needs to be empowered. They need to push back, and they need to demand the information they need to make an informed decision. Artificial intelligence brings so many opportunities, but it also brings a lot of challenges. The trick, how do we balance the promises of AI with the maintenance of trust, empathy, and effective communication, which is so critical to that doctor-patient relationship? With thoughtful, inclusive, and informed decision-making, we can preserve that sacred doctor-patient relationship and that sense of place in this disrupting age of AI. Thank you.